So thanks for having us. I would like to start from your movie. It's really touching. And I saw a familiar face on the... He's one of your actors.
Yes, Jonas is over there, one of the main characters.
I said, Lissane, great job. The story is really touching, and it feels like it's something personal, something that you know very well. Can you tell where this story comes from, please?
Yes. In my childhood, I had a mother who suffered from a depression, and also a brother who suffered from a form of psychosis. So I always felt like I was alone in this when I was younger, and that's why I tried to tell the story to, I don't know, maybe someone sees it and they think, oh, I'm not alone. You know, it doesn't have to be a psychosis, but I guess the worrying about someone you love is a universal feeling.
Thanks for sharing.
You're welcome.
I mean, there's a line.
Nerve-wracking.
No, there's a line that really touched me is when the doctor is out of the frame and says, when it happens to your own children.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
I think
a
movie like this can help people who doesn't understand this topic to get in. So thank you so much.
You're welcome. Yeah, I think it's always a story you hear in the news, and then you can't imagine that it's your own mother or brother or father, and then it happens to you, and then you can imagine, and then you make a movie to, you know, like therapy.
Viktor, talking about universal theme, your movie has a very particular location. It seems that could happen over there, but I think this is very universal. In the description of your film, you talk about social isolation, and I think we can have social isolation far in the mountains or in a big city as well. Why did you choose to talk about this emotional environment in your movie?
Well, it kind of started, I was on a bus and I saw these two boys that just had a very kind of beautiful and sincere friendship. It was kind of obvious by just watching them. And that sort of inspired me to kind of look into that sort of theme and explore friendship, and I think male friendship in particular is kind of interesting because it really, we don't really go out of our way to like say I love you, you know, to our friends. We kind of, you know, do it with other actions and like, you know, punching each other on the shoulder and that kind of stuff. And I feel that, you know, this is changing now for the better, and I feel like boys need to be better at recognizing their emotions and talking about it and the importance of you know, having a close friend. Really, what was the, does that answer your question? That's sort of how it, you know, came to fruition. That was like the seed.
I'm a little bit older than you guys, little. But my point of view is always is from a parent point of view. I have children. And I really found the parents in both of your movies inadequate to the situation their children are facing off. That was in your mind while you were writing your story, Viktor? Or parents are always inadequate?
I felt that it was important to kind of feel that she doesn't really understand him. She doesn't understand his needs are maybe a little bit different from everyone's needs. I saw it on TikTok the other day. It was a really good sentence. It said, fair doesn't mean that everybody gets the same thing. Fair means everybody gets the things that they need to succeed. And I feel that that was a bit of a theme in tonight's films, like more than just more than mine. And yeah, I think that's is a powerful truth, in my opinion.
What about the description of your parents? I mean, everything seems to stay on the brother. I mean, as
yeah, they person. Don't want to portray the parents as bad people or like they didn't care. But I think the parents understand it from a different kind of perspective. They know and they can think about it. But for children, they don't really know what. I remember I didn't even know what a psychosis was when this happened. And I think for children, they don't really understand, but they feel it. So it's kind of a different experience. And that's what I wanted to show. So I didn't necessarily want to leave the parents out. But yeah, I just thought it was more interesting to show the child perspective.
David, from your point of view, from your professional point of view, what are your thoughts after watching this five beautiful movies?
One, the amazing movies. Congratulations to both of you and to the other directors and the actors. Just amazing, touching. I think the whole theme of this growing pains is really the point of it. As kids grow, they go through different stages and different things, and they're not always well understood. For example, mental health is something we're beginning to understand that it's touching many, many children, and yet there's a lot of stigma around it, a lot of misunderstanding. So many children go through mental health stages. I mean, half of the kids who have mental health problems get them in before 10, and another three quarters have them before the age of 14. So this is very young. And some of these children that we have seen are also very young, like Braggy. And it's hard sometimes for parents to understand that their kid is growing up in a way which feels to them not normal. It feels to them that it's, and they feel frustrated, they don't really know how to help them, they just want their kid to be okay. Instead of probably us all understanding that they are okay. They don't need to be fixed. They just need, as you said, Frederica, to be supported in what they need. And it's not just parents, it's society. Society needs to begin to understand that mental health, these kinds of issues of growing up, are everyone's issues. And that we've all gone through them. We may not have expressed them as these children had tonight, but we've all gone through them. And we need to discuss and talk about them, because unless we do bring this under the table and we change the discourse from being one of negativity to one that is a normality, that we're all going to go through mental health struggles, unless we change that discourse, they'll still be in the shadows, as you two have really wonderfully illustrated.
There's another thing I can see in both of your movies. I can't say they have an happy ending, but they have an open ending. Thanks, especially in your movie, Viktor. I was terrified on the scene before the last one, but you let something open there. So is a message of hope?
Yeah, it's a bit grotesque, you know, watching a child this young swallowing all of these pills, and it definitely meant to make you feel bad, of course. But I feel like you said, you know, as a society, it's our job to have empathy and kind of witness what other people are going through. So I felt that I kind of wanted to leave the audience with, you know, he's not gonna come to you. Like, you have to see him. You have to see who this person is, and you have to listen when he speaks, and you know, really, that's the way. I kind of wanted the audience to kind of be like, I want to help. How can I help? Kind of want to reach out, in a sense.
What about your ending?
What about my ending? I didn't want it to be too cheesy, like everything is better in the end. I didn't think that was realistic, but I did want something hopeful. So I thought, you know, it's most beautiful when at least the two brothers reconnect. And that's the only thing I can say for sure will help, I guess, the love from someone else and all the things about mental health institutions and pills and all these things, if they help, for who they help. I don't know. I'm not a professional in this field, so I just wanted to give a hopeful ending and at least maybe give a message about love or care. Yeah.
David, what's the keys to make some progress about this issue?
I think openness, but also, as you said just now, just love and the care, you know, surround them with love and care at every level. You know, obviously starting with the family, it's tough for parents. Parents need support. Parents need often parenting programs that help them understand what their children are going through. Frontline workers, teachers, and the people that they also interact with also need to be able to understand, because there's a lot of pressure on that. But also other children need to understand and to understand these kinds of issues. And we come back to the theme of talking about this. And these movies are showing us the stories that sometimes some of our reports probably can't bring out. One of the reasons I think Innocenti has gone to this film festival is to really complement what we do by telling the stories behind the numbers. You know, each of these children could be a number in some statistic, but they're a child. And that's the real point of it, to put the child at the center and to make sure that their voices are heard. And we've had this wonderful movies by you wonderful directors and actor to begin to try and tell us what children feel. And that's what we need to listen to.
Any question from the audience? Don't be shy. Please.
Hello. I had a question to Lissane. I really loved the movie. The only thing that I didn't quite understand was what was the significance of the girl in the mental hospital. There were like two scenes with her, but I didn't quite understand what it was for.
Thank you. That's a good question. And I did have a previous edit where I left her out because I didn't feel like I fully made this storyline work. But I wanted this kind of soulmate for the little brother who was struggling. And I wanted to show that he was also in his puberty and maybe he kind of liked this girl and she had the same kind of issue. But I do realize that I should have done a little bit more maybe to make it more clear. So on my next film, I will totally make it work. Thank you for your question. It's a good question.
Any other questions? Avanti, per favore, grazie.
Two terrific films. I definitely felt the loss of innocence for the parents, the Dutch parents. I don't know if it was intentional, but I definitely felt they were helpless in trying to react to what was going on. And I anticipated a loss of innocence for your parents. For the mother in Iceland, because she had some trouble. She would be having more trouble in the future, yeah? So the open-ended ending was brilliant in that sense, I thought. But I'm older than you guys, so I empathize for the adults. So any thoughts about that?
Well, I think the parents were a little bit further in their process, and maybe they left the children out to protect them as well, you know, or the little children, I think, in my film. So they were trying, but yeah, what can you do? I mean, yeah, it's hard.
Yeah, it's kind of the same, like, Brian's mom, she's really trying. She just again, is not listening to what he really needs. And so she's going the route of what us as a society says, like, you have to, you know, ace this and this and this at school, and then you'll be, you know, an upstanding citizen. But, like, will you be happy? Will you have, like, good mental health? I don't necessarily prescribe to that. I think we need to, you know, focus on strengths. Because a lot of what is happening with Braille is that, you know, he's obviously, he's clever, he's resourceful, you know, and you know, a bit musical. But the main focus in his life is put on what he's bad at. And that's obviously has a very negative effect on people. Like, you wouldn't, it's a popular saying back home, like, you don't put the, like, that national sport team, like in handball, we don't judge them by how good they are in ballet. You know, we don't put them in ballet training. Like, we make them train handball because that's their strength. So, yeah, that's kind of my thoughts.
And what about the line, you can just play football instead of playing a drum kit? Do you like football?
Yeah, you know, I was into basketball myself. But no, it was just a bit of, you know, story device to kind of paint a picture a little bit.
Poi là, una domanda prima qua davanti, poi.
Hi, thank you for showing this to the world. I think there is something that connects to what you just said about football and what it means to be a kid, but specifically to be a boy. I think both the movies actually show, like, kids, but also, like, everyone in this room, that men and kids and boys are allowed to cry. And I think that's really powerful. And it's started to change the narrative a bit of masculinity. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, if you were actually creating this, like, out of an intention, or was it just organic, how it turned it out? So I want to thank you both. Also, what about this tequila? Thank you.
It was actually, we wanted to find some music that a band that consists of a drummer and a bass player would kind of make sense and carry a little bit. And my producer, he's brilliant. He came up with the idea for tequila, and I was instantly sold. It's hilarious to me. You know, I worked a lot with the kids. I trained them or, like, helped them. Neither of them had touched an instrument before this, so this was an exercise in patience. But yeah, it was phenomenal to work with them, and very. I think, yeah, tequila is the perfect song for their little band. And regarding masculinity, I definitely want to, you know, touch on that and kind of, I think there, I was trying to kind of mimic a little bit of that friendship I saw on the bus that day, and kind of have them be sincere and not have this, you know, facade of you know, the masculinity and kind of, you know, because it hinders you. It's something that kind of, you know, puts you down, and you don't really feel comfortable expressing yourself. And that was really important. And another thing that my producer did that kind of connected us in the first place was that he made a Facebook group called, like, Guy Meeting, is a rough translation, which is, the point of it is to have guys meet, just guys, and really just talk and not, you know, have, and just break down the walls. You know, it's fine. Like, we'll cry, you'll do whatever. You know, I need help, I feel bad, this happened. You just event, and no judgment, and no, like, oh, you're this and that, blah, 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 negative connotations. So that really kind of solidified our mentality for this, and that's, kind of what we wanted to drive at is that to break down these walls and allow men to feel, really.
Yeah, I can definitely relate to what you're saying. I started writing from my own perspective, which is the young girl in the film. And then at some point, I had a conversation about it with some people, and I realized it would be more strong to tell it from a boy perspective. And then I realized how my other middle brother was always struggling and how we never spoke about it and how he could never speak about it. And that's why he's drinking all the beers and playing soccer on his own. I thought it was more interesting to do it from his perspective, exactly because of what you're saying, that I think it's harder for young men or for men in general to express their feelings. Just more natural for girls, or more accepted, I guess, even though we all have the same feelings, so it shouldn't be that way, I think. Yeah.
C'era un'altra domanda. There was another question.
I was going to say something similar about both of your films. Look at a supportive, caring relationship between two male characters in both films, and that it's refreshing to see this kind of reaction against toxic masculinity. So thank you for that. And then another kind of reflection is this fallout of mental health challenges, that it's the brother that's carrying the weight of his brother's mental health challenges, and what implications does that have for him? And also the friend, Fryer, I think his name is, you know, what would the implications be for him if you know, the protagonist succeeded in what he was trying to do in that second to last scene? So I think they're both very powerful film, so thank you.
Any other question? You want to say something?
The thing about the friend is that this village is not really, you know, displayed in the film. It's a 9-hour drive from Reykjavik, so they are very much separated, and maybe they'll see each other again next summer, which in the life of a child, that's massive. That's like you're not seeing your best friend for 4 years, you know, to put it into perspective, because of course, like, time is kind of slower for them. So yeah, when he moves away again, it's really like, this is it, like they won't see each other, you know. It's very, it's quite a bit of a travel to make, and like we see, I don't think Breyer's mom would make the effort, and Freyr's parents, they weren't there. He was with his grandma, so I don't think the adults are aware of the importance of their connection and relationship, and so it pretty much just, that was the end of it.
Want to say something?
I was thinking about the relationship between the brothers and how it's important for a child to have someone to talk to. And as an adult, you might go to your partner or your best friend and you say, hey, I have a problem, can we speak about it? And if it's a real problem, you hopefully accept to go to therapy or something like this. But when you're a child, you don't have the words to describe it, or you're too afraid that you will be weird, or maybe children, they don't call for help that easily. So it's very important to have a friend or a brother or a sister to share things with. And I can imagine it's very scary when they leave for the summer or for whatever.
David, but sometimes a child doesn't have a brother or a sister, or maybe their parents are too busy, or just they don't know what's going to happen. So what are the priorities to try to help these people?
I think friendship, as you saw in the movie, and I think that's been really emphasized by COVID, with a lot of kids who've been isolated at home, and you know, they've gone online and they've been able to have that connection with others, and we've realized how important these social networks and these friendships are to children. And I think, as you were saying, I mean, you know, the issue is you think of school as being the place of learning a lot of it, but a lot of it that came out from some of the research said with the social networks, with the friendships and the peer relationships and the acquaintanceship and even the relationships with teachers, that was lost when the pandemic came in. So I think there's an idea and understanding, and hopefully this will become more widespread, that, you know, growing up is not just about education, yeah? And I think a lot of the time, sometimes after they get past the early years when their survival is no longer in question, the big thing that we focus on is education, 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 and that's great and necessary, but it's not sufficient for their development. And we need to take into account a much wider landscape of what children are about. And I think these films, both of them, really illustrated that, and particularly the power of friendship, either with your brother or friendship with somebody that you meet and you find this bond with.
Thank you. We have time for one last question.
Thank you all so much for your work, and also for your words this evening. For me, the main theme that I got from all five of the short films was this impression of children, and you've touched on this, not really being able to express themselves, whether that's because they don't have the vocabulary in terms of words, or they don't have the sort of emotional vocabulary that requires. So I was sort of wondering, in your experience, both making these films and watching the other films that we've watched tonight, if you've learned anything about how to allow children to express themselves in a sort of non-invasive way, I suppose. Thank you.
Yeah, good question. Difficult. I don't have kids, and you know, just worked with these guys, and what really kind of worked for me was just mutual respect for them as individuals and for their you know, intelligence, because kids know a lot more than we give them credit for. They're really clever, they're very, you know, they're individuals, and you know, we kind of worked as a group of peers. Everybody in the group, we all got like ADHD, and it was like a complete nightmare sometimes. Like we had to have like safe words, because like, okay, now we're not, no one's working anymore, so banana, and we need to, you know, get back to it. So yeah, I think for me it's just, you know, listen to them and respect them as you would any other person. And, you know, it's kind of just ageism to discriminate against them because of their, you know, age.
That's funny. Banana. I'm going to remember that. Well, I don't have children either, but I worked with the little girl who was 14. Jonas is already an adult. And the middle one's 16, 17? Maybe he just turned 17. Well, they were very professional, to be honest, so I don't... Yeah, I didn't really treat them different than I would treat any other adult. So I think you should take children very seriously, and with some you might need some patience and maybe sometimes not words. And I really like theater and acting, so I think for some children that works really well to explore different emotions and feelings and words. And I'm not sure if it works for everyone. For another one, drumming is the way to express themselves. So I don't think there's one way, but never ever think of a child as not capable, just keep looking, I guess. Yeah.
Well, it's like 5 minutes after midnight. Thanks for staying with us so late, and thanks for your wonderful movies, Lissane, Viktor. Thank you, David, and thank you all. I'll see you tomorrow. We have a very interesting workshop about working ethically with children in documentaries at 6 p.m. And then we'll have the Iris Award ceremony late in the evening. Thank you so much. Good night. Buonanotte.